Hi everyone, welcome to Remember the Magic, the show covering all things extinct from Disney parks around the globe. Wow, it's been a long time since the last episode in this series, and before you even ask, no, I'm not covering Believe There's Magic in the Stars today. Maybe in the future. With that said, there will be many more of these over the summer. In fact, almost every video I have planned for the summer is either an episode of Live the Magic or Remember the Magic, and with a new video every 3 days, yeah, there will be a lot more of these. In today's episode, I will be talking about another Disney parade and another favorite of mine, Spectromagic at Walt Disney World's Magic Kingdom. I chose this topic for today's episode because today, June 5th, 2020, is the 10th anniversary of this parade's hiatus. We'll talk about that in a bit. So without any further ado, let's begin. The history of this parade actually dates all the way back to 1972 in Disneyland, as this was the opening year of the Main Street Electric. Oh my god, this again? We're doing another video on this parade. I think I've at least mentioned it in every video on this channel since 2016. What do you mean this makes up for the last time when I didn't mention it once? All right, I'll get back to the script. The original Main Street Electrical Parade premiered in Disneyland on June 17th, 1972, and was both technically revolutionary and incredibly popular despite having numerous issues during its first performance. In 1974, this version of the parade was retired to make room for the bicentennial America on Parade. This gave Disney some time to recreate the electrical parade, as they now knew what they were doing. On June 11th, 1977, Disney premiered two versions of this parade, one in Disneyland and one in the Magic Kingdom of Walt Disney World. The latter is what concerns us today, but the Disneyland version will appear later when you least expect it. The Magic Kingdom's Main Street Electrical Parade was almost identical to the Disneyland version, aside from being slightly wider, along with a few minor differences. Anyway,
Walt Disney World's Main Street Electrical Parade
held its last ever performance in the Magic Kingdom on September 14th, 1991. After which, it was shipped to Paris in order to be featured on opening day of the then-named Euro Disneyland. With the Magic Kingdom now without its signature nighttime parade, WDI decided to create a new one. But instead of just another clone, there were three of them at this point, by the way, they came up with an entirely new concept. But by now, they had almost 20 years of experience. They knew how to make a good light parade. And that's exactly what they did. On October 1st, 1991, to celebrate Walt Disney World's 20th anniversary, Spectromagic premiered on Main Street, USA. To say this parade was stunning would be an understatement. I'll dive deeper into the brilliance of the design of this parade later, but for now, let's continue talking about the history. Spectromagic was incredibly popular, such that it stuck around long after the 20th anniversary celebration ended. This parade went on its first hiatus on May 21st, 1999, in order to give the Main Street Electrical Parade a quote-unquote farewell run for Disney World's Millennium Celebration. And compared to the other special things Disney did for the Millennium Celebration, this was easily the best. However, Disneyland Paris still had the original Walt Disney World version of the Main Street Electrical Parade, so Walt Disney World borrowed Disneyland's version, which ended in its 25-year run in 1996. The parade returned to the Magic Kingdom on May 21st, 1999, and stayed in the Magic Kingdom for 2 years. Then, in 2001, it was moved to the recently opened Disney's California Adventure, which was struggling financially, and Disney thought that shipping the parade back to California would boost the park's nighttime attendance. So on April 1st, 2001,
the Magic Kingdom's Main Street Electrical Parade
held its last ever performance at the Magic Kingdom. And on April 2nd, Spectromagic returned. There were few to no changes to the parade after its 2-year hiatus, but fans were still overjoyed to see its return. Spectromagic consistently ran until June 4th, 2010, when it went on its second hiatus. Though to explain this decision, we have to go back a bit. The 1977 version of Disneyland's Main Street Electrical Parade ran in Disney's California Adventure until 2008, when the Disneyland Resort announced the 2009 Summer Nightastic. Among other things, Disneyland announced that they would be updating the Main Street Electrical Parade that likely would have started to fall apart if they had waited any longer. Then, on June 12, 2009, the newly revamped Main Street Electrical Parade made its premiere in Disney's California Adventure. This update proved very popular, so when Disney closed the parade route in 2010 to make way for World of Color construction, and by complete coincidence Walt Disney World was introducing their own version of the Summer Nightastic, they decided to ship the parade back across the country to Florida to do what I like to call the "no seriously, it's really ending here this time" run. This decision would unfortunately claim a casualty in Spectromagic. To understand why a decision like this would cause any kind of storage issue, you have to understand a bit of Magic Kingdom backstage geography. As shown on this map, the main parade storage area is right here, behind Splash Mountain. This is where Disney stores all of the Magic Kingdom parade floats. However, in the case of Spectromagic, the Magic Kingdom never thought they would have to store two nighttime parades at once. So while the Main Street Electrical Parade took up residency in the main warehouse, Spectromagic was shipped all the way across the Magic Kingdom to here, a temporary, non-climate-controlled storage tent set up in the back of the Magic Kingdom. See the possibility of a disaster here? Anyway, Disney assured guests that the Main Street Electrical Parade was only in the Magic Kingdom temporarily, and that Spectromagic would return in August. However, the Main Street Electrical Parade's run kept getting extended, and extended, and extended, and at this point, fans began to wonder about the fate of Spectromagic. In truth, Disney was still holding on to the parade in the previously mentioned tent, but the floats were in terrible condition. In 2013, rumors began to circulate that the parade was being taken apart and thrown into dumpsters backstage, and unfortunately, not long after that, Disney confirmed that Spectromagic would not return and that the Main Street Electrical Parade would now have an open-ended run at the Magic Kingdom. Many years later, this open-ended run concluded, and on October 9th, 2016,
the Magic Kingdom's Main Street Electrical Parade
held its last ever performance to date, for real this time. The parade was sent back to Disneyland, where it appeared in Disneyland Park between January 19th and August 20th, 2017. When it held its last performance and was never seen again, oh my god, are you kidding me? With the Main Street Electrical Parade gone from the Magic Kingdom and Spectromagic no longer in existence, there is currently no nighttime parade at the Magic Kingdom aside from special events. One can only hope they'll get a nighttime parade for the 50th in 2021, but judging by the current financial situation of the company, I'd say that's incredibly unlikely. Now let's move on to the design. I tried this in the last video and I think it worked pretty well, so I'm gonna try and put this in consistently from now on. If I had to rank all the domestic nighttime parades from before Paint the Night, they would go like this. Light Magic is pure garbage. The two Main Street Electrical Parades are second and third best, with Disneyland's ranking slightly higher, and Spectromagic is the best. Don't get me wrong, I love the Main Street Electrical Parade. It's the original, and it has about as much charm as Disneyland itself. But Spectromagic is just an improvement in every way. By 1991, they had really figured out how to make a stunning nighttime parade. From the opening float to the color-changing finale, end to end, this is one of the most beautiful parades of all time. One that clearly inspired later works like Fantillusion in Tokyo and Paris, Paint the Night in Disneyland, and Dream Lights in Tokyo. Every float in this parade is a masterpiece in its own right. Take any float from this parade and compare it to any float from the Main Street Electrical Parade, even the most beautiful ones don't hold a candle to Spectromagic. When Spectromagic was created, they already knew how to make a good electrical parade, but because this was the first non-Main Street Electrical Parade they created, it had its very own storyline. Okay, storyline may be a bit of an overstatement, because what Spectromagic had was a coherent theme throughout the entire parade. The idea was that the Spectromen were transporting you through different worlds. The world of music, from the Silly Symphonies, the wonder of Sleeping Beauty's garden, the fantasy of the Little Mermaid's ocean, the imagination of Fantasia, and the world of dreams in a grand Disney cavalcade. Okay, so not the most realized theme ever, nothing like Usatama, but it certainly had more of a theme than the greatest hits montage that is the Main Street Electrical Parade. And I'm beginning to realize I'm talking about that parade too much in this episode. Updated Main Street Electrical Parade history video coming soon. Anyway, I'm going to use some of this time to take a deep dive into Spectromagic's floats, as I feel like they deserve their own section. The opening. This unit features the Trumpeter's Float, the opener of this parade, four Whirly Spectrum and Ball units, the title float, and Mickey's Float. These are all stunning floats, most notably Mickey's, which features a smoke effect emerging from the bottom of the float. Just an amazingly designed unit. Moving on to the World of Music unit, this is one long float featuring, depending on what version you saw, either Roger Rabbit or the Genie conducting a live orchestra. Goofy is there as well as Chip and Dale on piano, as well as some unique characters such as these two cellos and the Lady of the Harp. There's also a metronome made of light that stays perfectly in time with the parade soundtrack. A small detail, but a greatly appreciated one. Moving on to the garden, this is a unit I believe inspired many electrical parades going forward, as there are floats in Fantillusion and Dreamlights that bear a striking resemblance to this unit. Anyway, Aurora's three fairies all have their own floats. Fauna is first of the three, with a beautiful peacock made of lights on the front of the float, and some beautiful color-changing flowers as well. Flora is next, and though her float does not feature anything other than fiberglass foliage, it's still a beautiful piece of the parade. Meriwether is last, and with her comes the aforementioned color-changing plants and a beautiful waterfall made of lights on the back of her float. In between those floats were also several dancers dressed up in light-up wings and other insect-like accessories. Next up is the unit with possibly the most interesting details, the Fantasy of the Little Mermaid's Ocean unit. This unit begins with some fish floats, which I believe are responsible for restoring the false hope that this parade would return someday due to this appearance for the 2012 presidential visit. Long story for another time. Anyway, after these assorted fish comes Ursula, a massive whirly unit designed to resemble the Big Bad from the film. Though not the same one, I believe this float absolutely inspired the Ursula float in the frightfully fun Halloween parade in Disneyland many years later. After this comes the Sea Float. Clearly inspired by the scrapped A Bit Bubbly unit from the original Main Street Electrical Parade, this float also features the only documented item that got saved from this parade's eventual fate, the Sebastian animatronic figure. This figure was removed prior to the floats being destroyed in 2013, and when the Festival of Fantasy premiered in 2014, they added this float to the front of the Little Mermaid float as a tribute to Spectromagic. I believe this float may have also inspired the Little Mermaid float from the Paint the Night Parade at Hong Kong Disneyland and the Disneyland Resort. This float also features many great effects, far too many to cover here, but some highlights are these ripples made from the objects touching the faux light-based waterline creating small waves, and these bubbles that seemingly rise from the bottom of the float to the top. Moving on to the Imagination of Fantasia unit, this is quite possibly one of my favorite units in any parade ever. Still not my favorite, but we'll get to that. The first float featured Hyacinth Hippo and Alligator, along with Madame Ampanova. The next float featured the Ostrich Glass dancing around a fountain with Bacchus sitting atop it. The next float featured Diana raising her bow, along with a beautiful scene of many Pegasi flying above the clouds, complete with this fog effect. Then on to the main event of the Fantasia unit, the Chernabog float. This amazing spectacle of technological ingenuity includes the unsuspecting mountain that shoots up a cloud of smoke and then reveals Chernabog himself. This float was probably the single most dazzling parade float ever made until Festival of Fantasy's Dragon. Anyway, last but not least comes my single favorite unit in pretty much any parade, the World of Dreams unit. This unit was game-changing. It was the first time Disney tried to create a color-changing unit. But in 1991, LED bulbs that changed color didn't exist, so Disney came up with a solution. In between all of the colored bulbs, they put in a white one. This way, the float could seemingly change color, though this effect was technically as simple as turning off one light and turning on another. This unit comes in three brilliant parts. The opening, featuring the three little pigs, Cinderella's pumpkin carriage, and the enchanted forest from Alice in Wonderland. The next float featured a literal carousel of Disney characters. This float featured the most lights on one parade float for the entire parade. Just beautiful. Finally came the finale float. This float featured the Evil Queen gazing into her magic mirror, Captain Hook on his pirate ship, the dwarves in their diamond mine, Pinocchio and Geppetto on Pleasure Island paying tribute to the Pleasure Island float from the Main Street Electrical Parade, and finally, Donald, Minnie Mouse, and Jiminy Cricket waving goodbye. Even though this parade only featured 100,000 more lights than the original Main Street Electrical Parade, it felt like so many more. Wow, that took up a lot of time, but it was totally worth it to discuss this parade's beauty in detail. Now time for my final thoughts. The history of this parade and its eventual demise is, in my opinion, the biggest tragedy to ever come to the Magic Kingdom. Yes, the loss of 20,000 Leagues was devastating, and yes, losing Mr. Toad was catastrophic, but those rides exist in other places. Spectromagic was unique to the Magic Kingdom, and it was replaced by the only parade that can be found at almost every Disney park around the globe. Spectromagic is an early example of Walt Disney World losing its unique identity. The most obvious examples of this problem are Epcot and Hollywood Studios, but because I talked about Epcot last time, let's dive into Hollywood Studios. In 2015, we lost many of the things that made Hollywood Studios unique. The Backlot Tour, Streets of America, Osborne Spectacle of Dancing Lights, and so much more. Then in 2017 came the final nail in the coffin. We lost the Great Movie Ride, the last original attraction from that park's opening day. And what did they replace all these things with, you ask? Well, the stuff that closed in 2015 was leveled and the land was diverted into two main projects. One was Toy Story Land, which can be found at Hong Kong Disneyland, Shanghai Disneyland, and Walt Disney Studios Paris. The other was Star Wars Galaxy's Edge, which can be found at Disneyland Park and in Walt Disney Studios Paris in 2021. And with the Great Movie Ride, well, that got replaced with the train wreck that is Mickey and Minnie's Runaway Railway, a ride that will soon be found at Disneyland Park and, let's face it, many other places around the globe. It's a screen-based ride, it's not that expensive to clone it. Anyway, do you see the problem here? One of Disney's most unique parks just became the great land of, oh, we can do that somewhere else, we don't need to wait for it here. At this point, to my knowledge, there are only two 100% unique attractions to Hollywood Studios. And those attractions are Muppet Vision 3D, on a technicality, and the Indiana Jones Epic Stunt Spectacular, which, to my surprise, still exists. And while both of these attractions are great, they're not anywhere near the same caliber of Epcot's unique attractions that are left. Even Magic Kingdom, a park that was quite literally cloned again and again, has more spectacular unique attractions, like the People Mover and the Carousel of Progress. And that brings me back to Spectromagic. Losing Spectromagic was an absolute travesty, not because of what replaced it, but because what it represents for the resort as a whole. And don't get me wrong, what replaced it has its problems too, but that's a topic for another video coming soon. As of today, it's been 10 years since Spectro went on its quote-unquote hiatus, and while I'm sad that it no longer exists, I'm more disappointed that the Magic Kingdom has no nighttime parade anymore. The Main Street Electrical Parade was on loan from Disneyland, so when they asked for it back, Walt Disney World had nothing to replace it with. So what is the conclusion? Well, if I was in charge of the Disney Company between 2010 and 2016, I would have done as follows. Still do Summer Nightastic. I have no problem with the fact that this event existed. It's the perks that overstayed their welcome that I take issue with. I would have kept the Main Street Electrical Parade through its 2010 run, and who knows, I may have even extended it. But I would have done one thing very differently. Make sure Spectromagic stayed in good condition. That was Disney management's big mistake. While the Main Street Electrical Parade was popular, they didn't care what was going on with Spectromagic. To them, Electrical Parade was popular, so why would they care about the thing that had been running uninterrupted since 2001? Then when people began caring less about the Electrical Parade because it had been there for such a long time, it was too late. Spectromagic was in disrepair and was in no condition to ever be brought down Main Street again. So they gave up, put most of it in dumpsters, put some in storage, and took what little there was left and cut it up into these pieces of Spectromagic history pins.
Yeah, I bought two of them, so what? They're cool.
I wish there was some kind of happy ending to this video. I wish Disney would announce that they held onto it this whole time for a special occasion and were waiting until the 50th to bring it back. But unfortunately, it's just not possible. Spectromagic is gone, and there's nothing anyone can do about it. I would like to end this episode with a line from the soundtrack of Spectromagic. Though we say goodbye, we cast a spell that won't be broken. Let this night forever live in our dreams.
So long!
I'm Jiminy Cricket.
And Spectromagic.
Thank you for watching this episode of Remember the Magic. If you enjoyed it, please consider liking the video and maybe even subscribing to my YouTube channel. There are a lot of videos coming out this summer you won't want to miss, so be sure to click the bell icon so you get notified when we upload a new video. And remember, the answers to where we're going often lie in our past. Have a great big beautiful day, and remember, tomorrow is just a dream away.
Remember